It has been 50, almost 51 years since Neil Armstrong set his foot on the moon and said those famous words.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Although all elements of the mission were extraordinarily complex, no one ever think of how unique would have been the cameras that were used to take the famous picture of the moon. In reality, you will discover that those cameras were just off-the-shelf cameras. I'm Dom, and today we're gonna discover the history of the cameras that went on the moon. Salve a tutti and welcome to a new episode about Curiosities. Today we are gonna walk together in the history of the cameras that went on the moon, and we're gonna discover which cameras are used today up in space. In the summer of 1962, Walter Schirra, who will soon become America's third man to orbit around Earth, went in a Houston photography shop and was presented with a Hasselblad 500C camera that was at the time a really high-end Swedish import camera. This had been recommended to him by photographer from Life and National Geographic. He was sort of an amateur photographer, says Jennifer Lavasher about Schirra. Schirra's camera was a much more sophisticated and expensive camera compared to the Ansco Autoset camera bought by John Glenn for $40 in a shop in Cocoa Beach, Florida. Glenn used the Ansco Autoset to take picture of Earth on the Friendship 7 mission in February 1962. The Hasselblad retailed at $500, more or less $3,400 in today's money, and it had a much, much larger negative compared to the 35mm from Glenn's camera. It also had interchangeable Carl Zeiss. It also had Carl Zeiss interchangeable lenses and film magazines. When NASA saw this camera, they liked it. So the space agency purchased some more to be taken in space. Although this was a off-the-shelf camera, you have to remember that in space there are radiation and other problems. So the NASA engineer tore apart these Hasselblad cameras and made them space-proof. They painted them all black. They were originally silver, so they painted them all black to avoid reflections. And they also had to astronaut-proof it. This because the astronaut had to use this camera using the massive gloves that they usually have, so they had to make larger buttons for them to use it in space. In a 1998 NASA interview, Schirra admitted that on his six orbits flight done in October 1962, he didn't have time to take pictures. But at the next flight the following spring, where there were 22 orbits, the astronaut Gordon Cooper was able to take amazing pictures out there. Hasselblad's Chris Coos admitted that at the time NASA was more concentrated on the technical side of the flights and that photography was something for an afterthought. It was in 1965 when NASA released a picture of the spacewalk that Ed White had done on the Gemini 4 mission that Hasselblad did 2 plus 2 and realized that the camera used was one of theirs. Then they got in touch with NASA to see if there was something that they could cooperate with and help. It was a relationship that resulted in one of the most amazing pictures of the 20th century, Earth rays, taken by astronaut Bill Anders from the command module of Apollo 8 on Christmas Eve 1968, and ultimately put a dozen Hasselblads on the moon's surface. By the time of Apollo, NASA and Hasselblad were working together on the 500EL model, suited for long-distance flights and for the vagaries of the lunar environment. The manufacturer developed a high-capacity film holder, while Eastman Kodak invented a thinner film emulsion that was allowing to take hundreds of pictures out of a single film magazine. A motorized advanced film system was added, and so was the Rousseau plate, a piece of glass that was put in front of the film plate that was imprinting crosses to the negative. Those crosses, you can see them today in all the lunar pictures and the one you can see now on the screen. They allowed to correct for film distortion and help in judging sizes and distances of objects, because on the moon there is no recognizable landmarks, there is no telephone pole nor house in the distance, says Rice. The shutter buttons and other controls were made larger for easier use with the thick gloves that they were used with the spacesuit, and some suggestions on settings were given to the astronaut for different types of scenarios. Among all the modifications, a special lubricant was created that was able to withstand the huge difference in temperature on the lunar surface. Like the earliest Hasselblad cameras from the final Mercury flight, the data camera lacked of a viewfinder, and as you know, taking a picture without a viewfinder is pretty hard. Instead, astronauts went through a special training here on Earth, where they had to learn to aim by feel on chest level, that is where the camera would be mounted on their spacesuit. They needed to know that the position of the camera along their bodies was going to produce a certain kind of image, says Lavasseur. It's no surprise that due to the lack of viewfinder, some of them were poorly framed. There are around 18,000 pictures taken during the Apollo project. There are plenty that aren't any good. On the 20th of July 1969, the Apollo 11 lunar module landed on the moon with two Hasselblad cameras, but only one of them went out with Neil Armstrong. This explains why nearly any picture taken of an astronaut on the surface during that first landing are of Armstrong crewmate Edwin Buzz Aldrin. Armstrong had the only camera for the nearly 2.5 hours the two walked in the Sea of Tranquility. An official NASA document describes how the Space Agency Public Affairs Department, scrambling to satisfy the world's media for photographs of the historic moonwalk, suddenly discovered an embarrassing oversight. They started looking for the best shot of Armstrong, according to a transcript included in the Apollo 11 Lunar Surface Journal. Soon, they were looking for any shot of Armstrong. In total, thousands of pictures came back from the 6 different Apollo missions, most of them taken with the Hasselblad cameras, some other with some specialized camera. But I will leave this in the description down below some interesting link to official NASA websites, where you can find more pictures about the different NASA missions and more information about which camera they used. But back on the moon, NASA was afraid that they didn't have enough fuel to get off the moon and back on the command module orbiting around the moon. And so for this reason, they set up a strict weight limit of what the astronaut could take back from the moon. Turns out that moon rock are more valuable than cameras. So the astronauts were instructed to leave the cameras on the moon and take the films with them. Because if they left the films on the moon, we wouldn't have the pictures today. And that's where the cameras are still today, up on the moon on the 6 different Apollo landing sites. Today's consumer cameras are still the preferred choice for NASA, and they are still used today on the International Space Station. Brands such as Nikon or Sony are one of the most used on the ISS, but even things such as iPhone and HTC mobile phones are used up there for videos, photos, or even Twitter. Consider that the first 4K commercial taken from the ISS was shot with a Sony A7 II. Full-frame mirrorless cameras that anybody could just go out there and buy it. So they do not use specialized cameras, or better, they do have unique cameras used on the outside of the space station and some other special camera. But the most used one are the Sony for videos and the Nikon for pictures, actually. That seems to be one of their preferred one. Another most famous used camera is the GoPro. Because it's such a small camera and can record in 4K or even 8K or 6K, the latest one, if I'm not wrong, those are pretty well used all around on the ISS, especially on spacewalk. They have this nice little box in which they're safe and they're taken out to take shot. And funny enough, one GoPro in 2016 was at the center of a funny episode of a missing SD card during a spacewalk. Feustel and his crewmate Ricky Arnold from the ISS Expedition 15 embarked on a scheduled spacewalk on the 16th of May 2016. Both of them are experienced astronauts and they have stared into the abyss of the universe, different times. They were working on some maintenance tasks of the station's external cooling system, and in between the jobs, Fausto was going to take some pictures with a seriously space-armed GoPro camera, except it was not to be.
The GoPro, I'm told that if it has a card in it, it should have a red light if it's recording.
And if it says no SD, what does that mean?
I think that means no card. We'll check it, though. Hang on.
What if it's in there? Well, we could put this one back in the bag, then, I guess.
That sounds like a good plan.
All right. Well, let's just forget it for now. I'll get it later, or I'll just not worry about it.
Anyway, the full length of the space walk can be found in the link down below. So if you want to watch it all, just go there in the description and click on the link. And although the moon is now littered with up to 12 Hasselblad cameras, along with the footprints of the brave man who made history the 20th July 1969, we have to thank Hasselblad that has given us those amazing historical pictures of our moon and the trust NASA puts every day into off-the-shelf consumer cameras such as Nikon or Sony to continue giving us those amazing photos of our home planet. And with this, we conclude a new episode about curiosities. More are in development, and don't worry, I will try to make them weekly. Now, I just need to find the time. Meanwhile, if you like this episode, just click the thumbs up. And if you haven't done it already, click the subscribe button and the little bell. And if you think that somebody else might be interested to know about the history of the cameras that went on the moon, or history of ghost photography, or some other odd curiosities, or tech reviews, then click the share button and share it with the world. If you have any questions about the cameras that went on the moon, the Hasselblad cameras, or any other cameras, or you have suggestions for any odd curiosity that you know about, just leave a comment down below, or you can find me on Twitter. Meanwhile, I thank you so much all for watching, and hope to see you next time. Thank you for watching. Alla prossima. Ciao.
Hey, Houston, I got a catch question about the GoPro real quick.
We're all ears. Go ahead.
I'm pushing the button. I see a no SD. Does that mean, do I need that to record? And if it's recording, is there supposed to be a red light on?